One of the wonders we are discovering in the Bible is that God has given us all the wisdom and direction we need for every situation. Our present situation in the lockdown is no exception. We've been going back and finding a little book tucked away in the Old Testament, the book of Habakkuk, often forgotten. And yet as we work our way through it in these devotions that I'm doing, we're discovering God's wisdom and help for us in our day. Habakkuk lived in confusing and bewildering times. They were the days of the meteoric rise of the Babylonian Empire. Habakkuk, probably a contemporary of Jeremiah, had lived through the wonderful days of good King Josiah. But then he saw all that disappear with his son Jehoahaz and Eliakim, as the nation wholesale moved away from God. He had pleaded that God would do something, and now as God was answering, he saw the rise of the Babylonians, and to be honest, he knew that it would mean the doom for the nation of Judah. I want you to imagine that. After a ministry of pleading with God to bring revival, to bring his people back, suddenly when God acts, his answers seem to make the whole situation far worse. That raises the question I think you and I are beginning to ask, and that is, how do we understand God's strange work in days like ours? Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, in his classic study of the book of Habakkuk, at the height of the fears of the Cold War, highlights it. Chapter 1, verse 12 gives us an incredible guide into answering that question. Let me read those words as we come today. "Are you not from everlasting, O Lord, my God, my Holy One? We shall not die. O Lord, you have ordained them, the Babylonians, as a judgment. And you, O Rock, have established them for reproof." Notice that one of the first things that Habakkuk does is he stops and thanks. I think that's the mark of the Christian. They refuse to simply react to the events around them, the news, all that's happening. They step back and stop and think. To be honest, the words he uses here in the book of Habakkuk and even here are staggering in their sheer honesty. Rather like Jeremiah in chapter 20, verse 8, he simply brings the anguish and confusion of his heart before the throne of God. But notice he doesn't walk away from God or sink into the naivety, "It'll just be better tomorrow." He takes them to God. In short, he refuses to let the media-driven narrative of his day drive his understanding and response. He brings himself back to God. And then notice the second thing he does. He begins by reminding himself what are immovable truths because they're rooted in God. Lloyd-Jones said very helpfully, "When you start to think, you must begin not with the immediate problem, but further back." Habakkuk does that in these verses. Just walk with me through it and just listen to what he says. He begins with, "Are you not from everlasting?" In other words, he's reaffirming God is never surprised. You and I, we're in the moment, we're overwhelmed, but not God. He is the grand master weaver, who, looking at the top of the tapestry, sees the beautiful, intricate design of all that he's making, when you and I are underneath and only see the loose, tangled threads and wonder what it means. He is the one who knows the beginning and the end, and every moment in it, even right now. And his hand is on it for his wise control. And then he follows it with three covenantal titles: "O Lord, my God, my Holy One." Those are a reaffirmation that he has drawn all of his dear children into a covenant. We are in family with God. The Old Testament has that lovely word, kesed, which means God's special covenant loyalty and love. His always and forever, never failing loyalty and love that will never fail. Jesus affirms that in John chapter 6, verse 39, when he says in his life, I shall lose none of all that he has given me. Do you see the logic? It works out something like this. Yes, at this moment I am overwhelmed, but you are not. My life is out of control, but you're in total control. I stand under the situation. You stand over it. You will keep me in your hands. The coronavirus cannot change that because you have made me your child and you do not change. I am no less secure in these days because you are no less Lord. Then he reminds himself of God's, that he is utterly sovereign at all times. O Lord, O Rock. I suspect it's fairly easy for all of us to affirm God's hand in good times. Habakkuk reminds us we also need to see the outline of his hand even in dark times. Admittedly, it raises some huge questions about the work of God in history in ways that you and I cannot understand. But equally, it becomes the key to finding hope. For instance, notice how that was true with Habakkuk in that last half of that verse. He says, O Lord, you have ordained them as a judgment, and you, O Rock, have established them as a reproof. In essence, he's saying, if you're utterly sovereign, then I see that you have raised up the Babylonians partly as an instrument of your judgment to the nations and even, sadly, to the sins in the nation of Judah. That they are a finely honed surgeon's tool to bring about good through the act of surgery. And that in his divine wisdom, God had ordained, established them for precisely that time to fulfill his work. Friend, I think you and I find ourselves very much in similar situations. But we are firmly in the hands of God in the strange work of our day. We will have to learn, as Habakkuk learned in his day, what he would write down in chapter 2, verse 4, we'll look at next week. Paul picks up in the book of Romans that incredible phrase, the righteous shall live by faith. That is the call of God to you and I today in our situation, to live by faith. We need, like Habakkuk, to stop and to think. Let us remember the solid ground we stand on. God does not change. Let us work through our concerns and to stand on that solid ground as we begin to wrestle with what we can understand and then leave all the unanswered questions in his hands in confidence, knowing that he will bring about his good work. Well, as we think about that, let's come together in prayer as we join together on this occasion. Let us pray. Sovereign Father, we turn our hearts to you, and we acknowledge your gracious hand this day. We find ourselves in days of exceedingly strange work. But we remind ourselves of the security of knowing that every event is filtered through your wisdom, is bounded and set limits by your power, and that in the end it will serve to display your unlimited, unimaginable grace to this world. Steady our hearts when we are tempted to doubt. grant your calming hand to be laid on our shoulders in our fears. Hold us when we weep in our tears. Remind us afresh today that your hand is strong, immovable, and never failing. And in your mercy, may you grant these days will be short. Gracious Lord, in our days, we as a generation, a nation, are being forced to recognize the frailty of our lives, the powerlessness of our wisdom, the consequences of our actions. Be kind and lead many to the Lord Jesus in this time. Bend the heart of our nation to the gospel. Embolden us, your people, to hold out the word of life. Strengthen us with hope to give our lives in service to others. Thank you for the support of one another in these days. Thank you for the celebrations of the births of new life and the healing of those unwell among us. Strengthen those who are in lockdown alone, we pray. Provide for those in economic hardship at a moment of great need and open our hearts to provide for them. Give wisdom to the leaders of our nation, of the chancellery, of the NHS, and of our fellowship. All this, Lord Jesus, we ask and pray in the gracious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, may the Lord grant you a lovely day today. God bless.